We will use this now through the session. This will remain with you. So if you later on want to learn more, you have the references, want to try, do things that you didn't have time to do today, you can still do it. So it allows you to follow up on today's session. And the session is basically an application of sensitivity analysis from beginning to end. So can I now maybe remove the link? So if we read the, I gave a little bit of an explanation at the top here of what this is aimed at doing. So the idea is to give you at least an idea, a flavor of sensitivity analysis, and by application of a couple of methods, regional sensitivity analysis and variance-based, the ones I commented this morning, through an application to a very simple Rainfor-Hanoff model. The model you will find a little bit of information here, and then you have access to the code, so if you want to understand what the model is doing in more specifically, you can. But it's essentially a Rainfor-Hanoff model similar to HBV, the one that you used yesterday, even simpler, because this model has so a very similar soil moisture accounting component, very similar to HBV, but a simplified groundwater and routing component. And so in practice, this model only has five parameters. And I thought of using HBV, it would have been possible, but you know, it would make the exercise a little bit more complicated, because handling more parameters makes things more complicated, and maybe for no particular reason, because after all, if you understand the concept on this one, then it's quite easy to transfer to more complex models. So I choose to stick to this simpler model, because we can really, hopefully, in the short time frame of the session, understand some of the key elements of sensitivity analysis. I'm also giving you data for one catchment in the US, the leaf catchment. It doesn't really matter. The point is that you will have access to time series of rainfall and potential evaporation for this catchment over 1 year. Daily data, so 365 data that you can use to force the model. And then we also have a time series of daily stream flow observations. So we can do, for example, we can define a metric of model performance, model accuracy, and look at sensitivity of that metric to the five parameters. And in particular, up here, yes, sorry, the definition of the metric of performance is given here. We will actually use two, the root mean square error. Everybody understand what RMSE is. And the other one is the volumetric bias. This is maybe more useful, particularly for hydrological models. The idea is that one takes the total simulated stream flow and the total stream flow in the observations, so sum them up, so one obtains the total volume that has been flowing through the catchment over the year of simulation, and compare the difference. So ideally, we would like our model to have exactly the same volumetric stream flow as the observations. That means the model is able to close the water balance. And any deviation from this, so a value of volumetric bias larger than zero, is indication that something is not working perfectly, and obviously the larger the bias, the less happy we are with the model. So we're gonna explore the sensitivity of these two error metrics to the five parameters. And the last bit of information that you need to know is what the parameter ranges for sampling and running Monte Carlo simulations. And these are given here. For example, maximum soil capacity, possible ranges is between 0 and 400 millimeter. And the other parameters have their own. This is like suggested ranges that you might use throughout the session. One of the things I was pointing out earlier today is that actually one might try also different ranges and maybe get different results if throughout the session you want to do this, like run things under different ranges and looking at the difference. You are very welcome to do that. This markdown, this file is structured in this way. So I'll give you, well, my suggestion on how I would do things. Then, of course, depending also on your level of familiarity with R, you might do different things. But my suggestion is that you can go through this file and well, obviously read the text, but when there are pieces of code, you can execute these pieces of code in R. Mm? So this is just really setting up the session. The very first piece of code is this one to install the package, the two packages that I gave you. But I think I understand all of you have installed these packages already. So we can probably skip this and we can instead load the packages, because you know in R you first have to install them and then every time you want to use them you have to load them. So what you can do is if you select the code and then copy, and then you go to R, you can either, well, you can paste them in the console terminal, or maybe if you want to maybe have an intermediate step where you copy them into a file just to keep track of what you are doing as you prefer, or otherwise directly execute them. And then, for example, if I select the next piece of code, so let's have a look, what does this piece of code do? Okay, it loads and plots the data, which is 1 year of daily observations of rainfall, potential evaporation, and flow. Okay, let's copy and paste. Okay, and if I do that, where is it? Sorry. Okay, here is what happens is it produces the three time series, well, it just plots the three time series of rainfall, potential evapotranspiration, and flow. If you want to check that this is what actually was expected, yeah, you see that the results is also printed here. So are they the same? Yes, they look like the same, so everything all right. Okay, then next step, well, if you want, we can also have a little bit more into, let's look at this. Do they look like time series of rainfall, evaporation, and flow? Yes, because you see we have rainfall event here, for example, which becomes flow here. Potential evapotranspiration has this kind of, okay, variations, but within a sort of seasonal pattern. This is also something we would expect. Okay, so everything fine here. Let's see what's the next step. Okay, the next step is, define the function the function to simulate high mode. Are you familiar with this type of syntax in R? You know, in R you can create your own function through this command. So if you just so this creates a function called highModSimSchool. These are the input arguments, so parameter of the model, rainfall, evaporation, time series. Here is the code. Depending on how much you want to dig deeper, you can go and look at the details of what this simulation code is doing, or if you don't want to know, you just want to use it. Again, just let's select it, copy, paste here. Nothing will happen. This is just a definition of the function, but what happens is that from now on we can use this function in R because it has been defined. Yes. Yeah? Okay, yeah. And then let's see what the next step is. Okay, let's set some the parameters to some tentative values, run the model, and plot the resulting stream flow time series. So again, we can copy and paste the code. And this is what we get. Just 1 second. And so we get these results, where now let's look at what is what. So the blue line is the flow data, and the black line is the flow simulation. So we are comparing observations to simulation. And
I have some problems with file leaf catch. Do we have it as an input file, or is it a function?
Can we just get to the end of this? I'll get to the end of this and then go around to help with the individual questions, okay? Can you just hold a second? Because I just want to show you an example of how to go through this. So you see then the text suggests to try and change one parameter, for example the second one, which was set to, no, sorry. The first one, S max, change it to another value, rerun, and possibly get a different results. And then you see that you have, at the end of this section, you have a set of questions. So these questions ask, what is the effect of varying one or the other parameter? What parameter controls what characteristics of the flow time series? And which parameter seems to be mostly influential on your output. So my suggestion, the way I would go about this is use the code that is here already, but then try and modify it in R in order to address these questions. These questions can be addressed just by using the code that you have been provided so far. And then we can, maybe I'll give you 10 minutes, 15 minutes to do this, and then we can catch up again and see what sensible answers to this are, and then move to the next session, okay? And I'll be around helping out and also asking any questions you might have. Is anyone not been able so far to run a simulation and plot the results? No, you all managed to get a plot like this. Yeah? So let's maybe try to look at it together. This is now what I have here is, so the code is is here, so blue is the data, and then I have two simulations, black and red, and the only difference between black and red is that the black was obtained with these parameter values and the red with this, so the third one has moved from 0.7 to 0.2. So let's see, you should, more or less all of you have tried this one. So again, the blue is zero with the third parameter equal to 0.7 and the red is with 0.2. Does this make sense or not? Can you give an explanation for this? So let's look, the third parameter was alpha. Yeah? So repartition coefficient, this one. So if we decrease alpha from 0.7 to 0.2, what happens? So more water in the slow path and less water in the fast path. Okay? So the red one has the red line has less flow in the fast path and more flow in the slow path. Is this sensible? Yeah, because you see that the red lines is a bit less responsive, no? It has lower peaks and then longer, higher recession phase, because water is held back in the slow path. More water is held back in the slow pathways, stays there, so the peak is less high, and then we have more waters over the day after the rainfall event, which is slowly coming out of that path. So, okay, so we see the impact of that. Let's change another one. Which one we might change? So, okay, this maximum soil moisture capacity. It's now at 200 millimeters. How we want to change it, increase or decrease? Decrease. Okay, let's put it very small. What do we expect? What happens? Higher peaks, because it's like we are reducing the storing capacity here, so more of the water will be transformed, more of the rainfall will be transformed quickly into discharge. So let's see if this is the case now. Maybe we can do this in green. Okay. Okay, we get the green line. And now we can compare the green to the red, and yes, the peaks have gone up, yeah? Because the soil is more shallow, so water pass through more quickly. Okay. Let's do another one. Okay, beta is the exponent in the soil moisture routine. So it's this parameter here. So somehow it appears into the computation of the discharge, though it's a bit difficult now on the top of my head to say what's the impact. It's less obvious. We could probably, you know, do a little bit of pencil and paper calculation and see, but let's just try it. So it's the second one. It's the second one, and the range is between 0 and 2. Okay, and now we can... Okay, so now it's a bit maybe small because it's 0.5. Let's put it, I don't know, to 1.5. Because it varies between 0 and 2, so we can't go much more than that. Another color, don't know. Let's try pink. Okay. And let's do this. I don't know what I did, but something that... Okay, let's see where it is. Okay, it's somewhere here, but it's not actually very different from the green lines. Why? You can you see it? It's somewhere here, the pink lines. It's not very different from the green line. Why? Did you do it? Did you try changing beta? Did you get something interesting? Because what I get moving away from the green line is actually doesn't change much. The pink line is somewhere here, but it's so close to the green that you can't almost see it. It's here, you see?
You changed beta.
Eh?
You changed beta.
Yeah, I changed beta and I get very similar trajectory to before. Well, yeah, one easy way to say to explain why is, well, maybe it's not very sensitive to beta, you know, because, but, or maybe it is sensitive to beta, but not when the others are set to this value. Maybe to see something in the variations of beta, we need to have to be in another, like, maybe this should be different. I don't know. Actually, one of the reasons why I was suggesting to do this exercise is not only for you to understand a little bit the model, but also to understand the complexity of doing sensitivity analysis manually. Because we could now start searching for other combinations of this value that make beta become important by trial and error. But we can stay till tomorrow morning here before we have tried them all. And this is also a very simple model with only 5 parameters. So imagine when you have a complex model with a dozen or even hundreds of parameters. So somehow this was also to kind of give motivation to do this in a more structured way with one of the techniques. And so I suggest that maybe we could really start moving on to the proper sensitivity analysis, so regional sensitivity analysis, maybe having in mind this question, does beta matter or not? Which parameters matter on our model predictions? And again, you have explanation of the method, what we are trying to do, everything here. So in principle, you should be able to work by yourself. I'll be walking around and we can have small discussion and then maybe we can catch up again in 10-15 minutes for a similar joint discussion, okay? It's the, now y is has been set equal to the root mean square error. So it's the root mean square error against the 5 parameters. So simple question, just to warm up on how to read this. If I stick to one value of alpha, for example, 0.4, why I have different values for the root mean square error? Why I don't have one value? Because it's the other parameters are also changing as well. So for a certain value of one parameter, we have a distribution because the others are changing, because we are now doing global sensitivity analysis, so they are changing simultaneously. Okay? And that's why we have a scatter of values. Now, from this one, from these scatter plots, which parameters seem to be more influential? Where do you expect sensitivity to be higher? Alpha and RF. Why? Why this one is more sensitive than this one? What's behind your thinking? Why did you say alpha is more influential?
Because it is more or less clear dependence.
Because there is some form of shape here. As I move left to right, alpha increase, but also RMSC increase. It's not a one-to-one relationship because everything is changing at the same time, but still there is a dependency somehow. While here you see it's total cloud. So if I am here, very low value of beta, I have a distribution of RMSC. And if I'm here, I have another distribution of RMSC, but they don't look very different. It's almost like a horizontal stripe, where it doesn't really matter if beta is low or high. So that is an indication of low sensitivity. So answer to previous question, is beta important? From here, it seems it's not particularly important. But let's look at the other objective function, maybe. If we now look at instead this one, so the bias, we get these results. So let me put them one next to the other. So this was RMSC, and this was bias. What parameters are influential on bias? Is beta important? Yeah, beta is important and SM is important. And now alpha and RF are not important anymore. Question, why? Why? Why these two are important for RMSC and these two are important for bias? So let's go back to our model. So alpha and RF are very influential on root mean square error. Instead, SM and beta are very influential on bias. Well, let's start from the last one. Bias is the difference between the overall volume, flow volume produced over a year by the model and by reality. So what model component is important to get that right? The soil moisture component. The water balance, the ability of the model to reproduce the water balance, only depends from this one. It depends by the fact that we get right the repartition between how much of the rainfall goes back to the atmosphere as evaporation and how much of it is put into our catchment and will sooner or later get to the river gauging station. This component, the routing component, only gives you the timing. So if it takes one day for the rainfall to get to the end of the catchment, or if it takes a week, or if it takes a month, because water is captured into the slow flow pathway. But sooner or late, what is sent into discharge will appear at the end in our stream flow. Maybe it takes a day, maybe it takes a week, depending on the parameters, but sooner or later it will be there. So if we only look at the volume aggregated over 1 year that we measure here, after all, how much, what's going on in the routing doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is to get this part right. Because, for example, if we have an SM such that we overestimate evapotranspiration, we lose a lot of water and underestimate the total volume. If instead we get an SM that is underestimating evapotranspiration, we send too much water to the catchment outlet, and we don't. And in reality, we lose more. So to get the water balance right, it's only this component that is active. Now, why root mean square error instead is so sensitive to alpha and RF? Because RMSE looks at the peaks, essentially. You get a good RMSE, low RMSE, if you get the peak right. If you get the peak wrong, RMSE becomes very bad. Okay, and to get the peak right, it's all about timing. That the time it takes in reality for rainfall to show up at the gauging station is the same as in the model. So this is telling you, and this goes back to what we were discussing earlier today, that which parameters are influential also depend at what output you look at. So that's all right. That actually totally makes sense that we have these different sensitivities. Now, this is what I would call a qualitative sensitivity analysis, because it's us looking at these plots and saying, yeah, I think this is sensitive because I see a pattern, this is sensitive because I see a pattern, this is not sensitive because I can't see any pattern. So it's visual, it's qualitative, it's our judgment. Now, if you go on, and this is maybe the last thing we can do, and do proper regional sensitivity analysis, the idea is to let, with that process of splitting input-output, looking at distribution and distance between distribution, let the computer do this assessment. So produce numbers that will tell us this is sensitive and this is not. And this is useful because I think visual analysis is very useful. My recommendation is always to look at things, because our brain is very good at spotting trends. So it's very good to do visual analysis. But if you have a model with 50 parameters and you want to maybe look at sensitivity over 5 different objective functions, you can't do this only visually. So it helps if you have numbers, sensitivity indices. So the next part is exactly this. Now, to apply regional sensitivity analysis to which starts numerically starts here, you can do it, for example, with RMSE and do regional sensitivity analysis and come up with numbers. Sensitivity indices. Again, give it a try and then we discuss together. Of simulations have reduced. Eh? Where is it? Initially we had so many, and now after selecting only the behavioral, we have less. You see that the black bands are smaller and they are closer to the simulations, because we have been now selecting only the behavioral. Behavioral means the ones that have a RMSE below 3 with this definition. Who says 3? Where does this magic number 3 comes from? Three what? Did you think about it? So it's a value of RMSE below 3. What is the range of variation of the RMSE in this case? Flow is in cubic meter per second, so the RMSE is also in cubic meter per second. And if we go back, where is it, to the scatter plot that we have here, yeah, you see that it varies between 2 and 9. So I can also, let me just have it here, it's easier. So we had in this example a root mean squared that was varying between 2 more or less and 9 in the worst case cubic meter per second. So this is the error we have on daily flows. So I have quite subjectively chosen that every model that has less than 3 is good. Every model that has the more than 3 is bad. We can discuss for days if this is a good choice or not. This is one limitation of regional sensitivity analysis, that everything that will follow is a consequence of this the definition of the threshold. Now, there are situations where definition of the threshold is kind of easy to make. For example, say that instead of being RMSE, it was, I don't know, Nash-Sutcliffe efficiency. You know that the value of NSE below zero means that the model is worse than just taking the average of the data. So, for example, that could be a good choice for a threshold because that's really not meaningful. In this case, maybe 3 is a bit subjective. Maybe it's worth looking at the impact of this choice. But okay, let's stick to with this decision. We get this reduction of the uncertainty in the predictions, and we get where is it? If we now look at the CDF, this is, so now the black line is the distribution function of the input samples that correspond to simulation below the threshold, and the gray one is above the threshold. So we said for regional sensitivity analysis, the idea is that if we find a difference in these distributions, it means that input is playing a role into having behavioral or non-behavioral. So which inputs are influential? The last 3. We are looking at RMSE, so we expect this. This is the case. And if you want, you can also, this function here also returns among other outputs, an output called stat. It's 5 numbers. 5 numbers because we have 5 parameters, and these are our sensitivity indices, which in this case are computed as, it's the Kolmogorov-Smirnov statistics. So basically is nothing else than the maximum absolute difference between the CDF, this vertical difference. And so it's nice because it's a number that ranges from 0 to 1. By definition, we can take it as a measure of sensitivity. So we see that the highest sensitivity is parameter number 3, which was alpha, which gets almost 0.5. And then the other 2 parameters of the routing components, while these 2, the one of these 2 of the soil moisture component have a very low sensitivity. Okay, so this is useful because imagine, as I was saying before, you have 50 parameters, you get 50 numbers, and without having to analyze plot by plot, you get these results. Okay, I leave this to you if later on you want to play. Obviously, if we now do the same analysis with bias, we are going probably to get that the numbers are higher for the first 2 parameters and lower for the others. OK? Okay. Now the next step is a variance-based sensitivity analysis. And actually the main point of doing this is, the main point of doing this are two. One, the idea was to look at whether we get similar results as with the regional sensitivity analysis. And in this case we do, but that's not always the case. And one of the points I wanted to make this morning, we didn't get there, is that actually the availability of different methods is a good thing, because another way to make sure that the results we get are we can trust is apply different methods and make sure that they give us consistent results. And so this was one of the points that I wanted to make. And the other one is that if we look at, I'll just quickly go through the file. If we do variance-based sensitivity analysis, at the very first attempt, we get numbers that are a bit strange. Mm? So, in particular, this sensitivity indices that we get when we run it the first time are very strange. Can you spot something strange here from what we discuss of? The meaning of these indices is the contribution to the variance of the output. So the number tell us what is the contribution of, for example, SM to the output variance. It's negative. This is totally just theoretically impossible, because it must be a number between 0 and 1. By definition, it's a contribution to variance. It can be 0, but it cannot be negative. Okay, and so this exercise was made, why do we get such strange result? Well, theoretically it's impossible, but in practice we do get it. If you run the code, this is what you get. So why can this happen? If you do Monte Carlo simulations and you get a number that is very strange, what could that be?
The distribution?
Yeah, the distribution of the output is clearly not well estimated. Why?
You may get a physical combination of parameters that leads to negative flows.
This is accounted for by the model. It's just simply really in the Monte Carlo simulation running too few, the sample size being too small. And it's like if you take, if you compute the average of throwing a dice by throwing the dice twice, maybe you get that the average is 6, because by chance you have thrown it 2 times only and you get 6 and 6 and the average is 6. The average is clearly, should be 3, but you only get a 3 if you do this many, many times. So the problem here was just the sample size. So if you then repeat everything with a larger sample, you finally get numbers that are feasible. This might take also a little bit of time on computers, because you need to run the model many, many times. I leave this with you. If you want to try it now, I'm happy to stay and chat around. Otherwise, you have all the code and the data to try and do this if you want. And so I would maybe rather use any last 5 remaining of the time if you have questions, or if you want to keep doing this and trying, or if you want to chat.
Tonya dashol the test three.
Ah, I made it to to this point, so maybe we'll just
help
those that are like that have some drawbacks. Yeah.
But otherwise, I mean, you have the code and everything. So my main point is because now we are over with time. If you want to try this later on and then want to get in touch, you have my contact details. And if you ever want to use any of this in your research, again, get in touch. I have plenty of materials and examples. So see if this is useful and maybe starting by finishing this exercise, and then you have also references to paper and things that could be useful, and if you think this could be something you would include in your research, we have several tools to do this. So yeah, we have also a version of this toolbox in for MATLAB, and we are preparing one for Python at the moment. So if you are not too much into R and you use other software, again, consider that this is available in other languages too.
I have a question.
Yeah.
When you look at the scatter plot, as I understand in theory, if we take the parameter values that relates to the for example, lowest bias, mm-hmm. lowest root mean square error, it means that we should just use these values for model run. It means that we should get the best model results. But it's not.
What do you mean?
No, just.
When you look at visually the trajectory, it doesn't look so nice.
No, if you just pick. For example, we see this dependence that the lower alpha, the lower bias.
Mm-hmm.
So I took this lower alpha value and then do the step one, model run.
Yeah.
And then I take each parameter that gives us this better model result. But when I combine, the result is the best model result.
Because you are combining from different...
Yes.
Yeah. So what you should do, what you can do... No, the problem is that you are combining things that come from different model runs.
Yes.
What you could do is, for example, this is RMSC. We can look, I think the lowest value of RMSC is this point.
Yes.
You can use, for example, in R, the mean function will tell you what is the index in your big matrix of parameters, which is called R. It will tell you which is the sample of parameters that produce this point here.
Okay.
And if you simulate that point, it should be good. But if you take the values separately from each other, exactly. Yeah, it's some other point that you are creating that we don't know how it will perform. But you're right that you can use now that we have run the Monte Carlo simulation, we might directly use these results, look at which is the combination that has the lowest RMSC, and say, okay, this is my best. So in a way, this is already a sort of simple calibration.
Mm-hmm. That's not the end curve. That's not the overall purpose of Monte Carlo simulation, mm-hmm. this particular instance.
Well, the thing is, what usually people use as calibration algorithm, like the genetic algorithm that was discussed yesterday, is basically, it also relies on some form of sampling, but just use computing resources more efficiently, because what we will do, like for example here, we have Where is it? We have run 1,000 samples, and then you just you just look at the best. What a genetic algorithm like the one that Ian was describing yesterday would do is maybe run 100, look at the results, understand that maybe there is a range of the input of the parameters that tend to produce better results, and so another 100, rather than sampling from the entire space, would sample more from that good region. And then, so it will maybe use fewer model runs to get to a good point, because it will do it interactively. Yeah, so it collects some feedback and then decide where to sample, and then collects feedback and decide where to sample, and so. So if you have a very complicated problem, probably that's more efficient, because you make best use of your computing time. So, but for a simple model like this, you can also do this calibration in this way. You just run as many as you can, and then look at which one is working best. Okay.